Earth is teeming with life, no matter where you might look, be it the lush jungles of Madagascar, the icy tundras of Siberia, or the vibrant coast of the Caribbean, you'll find fascinating creatures living there. Millions of species call our planet home, and scientists are discovering thousands of new ones every year. No one knows for certain how many there are in total, but some estimates are as high as 100 million different kinds. With this incredibly large amount of diversity comes an equally large challenge for scientists. How do we organize all of it? In today's lesson, we'll explore this topic as we describe how living things are categorized by scientists, evaluate the benefits and challenges of using taxonomic systems, and utilize these systems to determine relationships between living things. Let's get into it. In our last lesson, we learned about how living things rely on diversity to survive. Because of this, diversity is everywhere in nature. This has led scientists to ask an important question. What are the relationships between living things, and how do we understand them? Well, there's a whole scientific field for that called taxonomy, which is the science of classifying and naming species. In science, classifying refers to arranging things into groups based on shared qualities or characteristics. To illustrate just how difficult this is, I want you to imagine that you have a giant closet with millions of clothes in it. I know, this sounds both insanely awesome and stressful at the same time. Bear with me. Now, I also want you to imagine that you share this closet with thousands of people, and you have to compromise with them on how to organize everything. Do you think that there just might be a slight disagreement about the best way to go about it? Well, shockingly, scientists have also struggled to agree on an organizational system for living things. Because of this, the system has changed a lot over the years, and will continue to change as we discover more about the natural world. However, the type of system scientists use to classify living things has not changed in over 200 years. It's called a taxonomic system, and it was originally developed by a Swedish scientist named Carl Linnaeus. The taxonomic system is organized like a reverse pyramid or funnel, with levels that become more and more specific as you move down the funnel. These levels, from least specific to most specific, are domain, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, and species. Domain is the broadest or least specific level, including millions of different organisms, while species is the most specific and includes only one type of organism. To help you remember the order of these levels, let's use a mnemonic device. For example, Dear King Philip came over for good soup. The first letter of each word represents the first letter of each level of taxonomy from the top to the bottom. You may choose to use this one or create your own. Pause the video and write your own mnemonic device in your guided notes. Let's take a closer look at the taxonomic system. Starting with the broadest level, domain. There are three domains, archaea, bacteria, and eukarya. Archaea and bacteria are both prokaryotic, which means that they do not store their DNA in a nucleus. But they have key differences as well, such as the structure of their DNA. Meanwhile, the domain eukarya, as you might have guessed, is composed of eukaryotes, which do store their DNA in a nucleus, and are typically much more complex life forms than prokaryotes. Continuing along our funnel, our next stop is kingdoms. Archaea and bacteria don't have their own kingdoms because their structure is very simple. Eukarya, however, includes four kingdoms, which are plantae, animalia, fungi, and protista. Plantae and animalia are basically fancy words for plants and animals. Fungi includes funguses, such as mushrooms and molds, and protista includes all eukaryotes that are not plants, animals, or fungi. Kingdoms are then divided into various phyla, which are divided into classes, and so forth down the chain, becoming more and more specific until we eventually reach the species level. To illustrate how this works, let's use this system to classify a gray wolf. A wolf is a eukaryote, which means it belongs in the domain Eukarya, and it is an animal, which places it in the kingdom Animalia. It has a spinal cord, which puts it in the phylum Chordata, and it also happens to have fur and produce milk, so it belongs in the class Mammalia. Wolves also eat meat, so they belong in the order Carnivora. From here, things get pretty specific. Wolves belong to the family Canidae, which includes other organisms with shared traits such as foxes, jackals, coyotes, and wild dogs. Moving down to the next level, wolves belong in the genus Canis, which is even more specific than family, including only 6 species of wolves, jackals, and coyotes with very specific shared traits. Finally, the species is Canis lupus, of which there is only one member, our friend the gray wolf, who has traits that are entirely unique among the whole animal kingdom. Species get their scientific name by combining the genus and species together with both in italics and the genus name capitalized. Taxonomy assists with communication, because no matter which language a scientist speaks, the name Canis lupus will always mean gray wolf. Additionally, scientists can easily study the relationships between organisms by looking at which levels they have in common and which levels they don't. For example, do you think that this strange egg-laying animal, called a platypus, is more closely related to a duck or a beaver? Write your thoughts in your guided notes. Well, simply by looking at the taxonomic system, we can see that while the platypus shares the phylum Chordata with both beavers and ducks, the platypus is also a mammal, like the beaver. Because the class Mammalia is smaller or more specific than phylum, this tells us that our friend the platypus is more closely related to beavers. Earth is home to millions of strange creatures that aren't all what they seem. So taxonomy is an incredibly useful tool that helps scientists classify living things in a very structured and universal way. And with that, we have finished our lesson covering the basics of taxonomy. We have learned that taxonomy is the science of classifying and naming living things. Taxonomic systems are organized into levels and shaped like a funnel, with each level down becoming more and more specific. The broadest level is domain, which includes bacteria, archaea, and eukarya, and the most specific level is species. Organisms are given scientific names by putting their genus and species together. Finally, we've learned that while agreeing on how to classify millions of species is a huge challenge, taxonomy helps scientists better communicate and organize information in a universal way. In our next lesson, we'll dive into the kingdom Eukarya as we learn more about the characteristics of plants. Until then, I'm Tony, and remember, life is full of wonders, so keep learning and don't ever stop wondering. Hey!